Start off with Oman. What appears to be a smooth political transition at the very top after what has been the longest tenure for an Arab leader in recent history. When you look at the dynamics, though, from a fiscal perspective, from where the government stands in terms of its debt, I mean, what are your main takeaways here?
Yeah, I mean, I think with Oman, you've always had this risk in the background for the last many years. The Sultan obviously had not been well, and the transition was always one of the risks attached to Oman. And like you mentioned, given that so far it appears that it's a relatively smooth one, that risk will now recede into the background. But as Manus was saying, the fiscal slippage, the oil break-evens, the budget deficits, those are still factors that have to be battled with, that have to be dealt with. They took a positive step at the end of last year when they sold or privatized Oman Grid, which is one of the local utilities. So obviously the program for asset sales is continuing on, and they will likely once things settle down in the region, they will probably likely come an issue in the market because they still need to raise probably $2 to $3 billion this year in the market to fund their deficit. But I think the market is going to, want to see some more movement in terms of their fiscal discipline, in terms of trying to curtail some of the deficits, and in terms of trying to lower those oil break-evens.
So how are some of the sovereigns and corporates going to stack up, you think, in 2020 when it comes to issuances in particular? So Oman, unlikely to come out with anything bold. On the corporate side, are there going to be any gaps? Qatar, maybe?
Yeah, I mean, I think, Qatar, in general, our outlook for issuance is slightly lower than last year. Last year, we had about $100 billion. This year, we're saying 80. And part of that reduction is going to be Qatar. I think Qatar will probably not be as active. Abu Dhabi will be another one that issued last year, which will not probably issue this year. I think that, like I said, Oman will have to come. Saudi will obviously be the big issuer again this year. Bahrain will probably come at some point this year. But I think that if you look at, and I think Felipe mentioned this earlier on, the underperformance of Oman and the same is true on the fixed income side. If you look at Oman spreads, they trade almost 70, 80 basis points behind Bahrain, even though Oman is two notches higher than Bahrain. So, I think the markets are still quite concerned about how Oman is going to tackle these deficits, and it's definitely pricing in the Oman curve.
What about the spreads when it comes to emerging market bonds? I mean, they have been tighter. I mean, how much tighter can they really get?
Yeah, I mean, if you look at the spread on the MB, the spread on the MB is now back to where it was pre-2008 crisis. So clearly, it's not at its all-time tights, but it's at significantly tighter levels than it's been in the recent past. Having said that, though, the overall mood in emerging markets and amongst emerging market investors is still very constructive. The phase one China deal, the lower Brexit risks, the new NAFTA deal, general dollar weakness, these are all things that are contributing to a relatively positive mood in EM. And I think that is likely to drive returns this year. You had a very, very strong year last year, double-digit returns in EM. I think this year will probably be mid-single-digit returns. But I think that, a lot of these factors are going to keep emerging market investors positive.
You're telling clients to scale back a little bit when it comes to Egypt. We have a rate decision on Thursday. We're going to get another cut?
We probably will. I think the chances are the reason why we are a little bit less positive on Egypt is got nothing to do with the fundamentals. It's really just got to do with the technicals and the valuations. In hard currency emerging market, Egypt is one of the most overbought positions globally. The spreads, if you look at Egypt, is a single B credit, trades almost 100 basis points tighter than Sri Lanka, which is also a single B credit. Clearly different credit dynamics, so I'm not saying that they shouldn't trade tighter than Sri Lanka, but 100 basis points seems to us to be a little aggressive. So for us, I think it's more of a valuation story on Egypt rather than any significant near-term economic issues.
So when you look at the wider picture and take everything into consideration you're seeing both in terms of monetary policy and geopolitical tensions. What do you like comes to assets?
Well, I think we're still underweight the region versus global EM. I think that the geopolitical situation in the region, plus the fact that you had a very strong first 9 months of last year in GCC performance. They gave up a little bit in the fourth quarter. But I think within the region, we tend to focus more on individual stories. We're relatively defensive, so we like sort of the mid-quality type of paper. We like some of the bank perps in the region. I think Oman will be interesting once they issue. I think right now the market is pricing them, is pushing them wider because of the expected issuance. But I think once that's out of the way, you probably will get some performance
in Oman. Year.
And then outside the region, we like names like Ukraine and Mexico.